So there are estimates that there are about 2,000 Confederate memorials, statues honoring the Confederate States of America scattered all over the United States South. Many of these statues were erected between 1890 and 1930, a time of state-sanctioned discrimination and violence against African Americans in the form of segregation, disfranchisement, and lynching. This too was the era when the White South began to create the myth of the Confederacy, the Lost Cause, an event the White South portrayed as a noble effort to secure states' rights, an effort fought by brave men. And this myth, of course, erased the history of slavery as the major cause of the Civil War. So our panels today will explore the history of the Littlefield statues recently removed from the South Mall, the political firestone that has arisen over the statues, especially since 2015, when a young man named Dylan Roof murdered nine Charleston churchgoers and posted a picture of himself online with a Confederate flag. And we're also going to consider efforts to contextualize these statues as represented by the Briscoe's display of Jefferson Davis now. So with that, those three topics in mind, let me introduce our speakers, and I do want to say that the session this afternoon is being recorded. Our first speaker will be Walter Buenger, Chief Historian of the State Historical Association, Summerlee Foundation Chair in Texas History, and Barbara White Stuart, Centennial Professor in Texas History here at UT. A native West Texan long interested in the history and culture of Texas in the Southwest borderlands, Professor Buenger has written and edited numerous books, including The Path to a Modern South, Northeast Texas Between Reconstruction and the Great Depression, and others. He is currently the editor of the Southwestern Historical Quarterly and is editing and annotating the autobiography of a German language newspaper editor and state legislator who lived in Austin at the time the Confederate statues were designed and placed on the UT campus. So Professor Buenger will be giving us some historical perspective here. Our next speaker will be Peniel Joseph, the Barbara Jordan Chair in Ethics and Political Values and Founding Director at the Center for the Study of Race and Democracy at the LBJ School of Public Affairs and Professor of History here at UT. His career focus has been on Black Power Studies, which encompasses interdisciplinary fields such as Africana Studies, Law and Society, Women's and Ethnic Studies, and Political Science. His award-winning books include Waiting Till the Midnight Hour, A Narrative History of Black Power in America, Dark Nights, Bright Nights, From Black Power to Barack Obama, and most recently, the definitive biography of Stokely Carmichael called Stokely, A Life. He is currently at work on two book projects, one about the political worlds of Malcolm X and Martin Luther King Jr., and the other about black politics and policy in the age of Obama. And our third speaker, who will be giving context to the statues, is the Associate Director for Communication at the Briscoe Center for American History at UT Austin, Ben Wright. He is curator of From Commemoration to Education, Pompeo Coppini Statue of Jefferson Davis, which formerly was displayed on the South Wall. Ben's postgraduate work at King's College London focused on World War I, particularly the speech making of Woodrow Wilson. A former journalist and Capitol Press Secretary, he is the Briscoe Center's contact for media relations. So I have limited our speakers to 10 minutes each in the hope that we will have a discussion after the presentations. Walter?
Thank you.
Do you want me to use the microphone?
Yeah. And you want to keep recording that?
No, that's all right. I can set up.
So can everybody hear me in the back?
Mm-hmm.
Good.
good. I want to start with a quote from the autobiography or memoirs of Francis Richard Lubbock, who was the governor of Texas during the Civil War. And he wrote these memoirs in the 1890s and published in 1900. So let me read the quote, and then I'll explain to you why it's important. The morning of January 14th, 1874, dawned upon Texas redeemed from radical rule, upon Texas free and at peace for the first time since 1861. With the restoration of white supremacy and democratic rule, and he meant Democratic Party, Texas started anew on a prosperous career. So I would argue that this quote tells you something about the time period and that it operates sort of like the statues did. They purport to be written about the Reconstruction, or the statues to display something about the Civil War. But what they actually do is tell you something about the time they were created. So that quote tells you something about 1895 to 1920, just as the statues tell you something about 1895 to 1920 or 1930, and often only misleading things about the Civil War. So the things that I suspect we should emphasize out of that quote is the democratic rule, by which he meant more or less Anglo unity. The white supremacy, very much the order of the day at the turn of the century. The drive for prosperity and peace. And he did not mean necessarily, and the elites of the time did not mean necessarily peace with African Americans, or peace with Mexican Americans, or peace with German Americans, but peace among the Anglo community North and South. And that this bundle of Anglo unity, white supremacy, peace would bring prosperity. So again, two levels. That's what the statues do. They're part of the bundle. They're part of the bundle that is to bring peace and prosperity, white supremacy and unity. Also in the bundle would be something like the poll tax passed in 1902, which limited who could vote to only the better sort, typically white. The all-white primary, which limited who could vote in the Democratic primary only to whites and lasted in Texas from 1905 until the mid-1940s. And then the various segregation laws that came online, and then the statues. They're all of a piece. And so what the statues do is they're sort of anchors of memory. And I say memory intentionally as opposed to history, because memory is something that is an act of remembering, but it's also an act of forgetting. So any of you who used to play basketball, for example, you used to jump higher than you probably really did. In your memory, you jumped, you know, 10 feet and dunked over the back of your head. And in reality, of course, you never did that. But your memory has changed it to enhance how you think about yourself, to enhance the present. So memory is about the present, and it is about forgetting, disputes, brutality, slavery, destruction, death, defeat. You forget all of those things, and instead you remember the glorious things, the valor, the honor. And so you construct through the statues and through the memoirs and through the writings and through the laws, through this bundle of things, you construct. There was constructed a sort of milieu of a noble past that obscured, as Professor Jones said, slavery as a cause of the Civil War, that obscured the murders, brutality of the Reconstruction era. You construct a past that is separate from defeat. Texas is interesting because a part of that construction would also be the elevation in this period of the Alamo and Texas symbols to a level that helped additionally separate from defeat. And these constructions of the past help make Texas part of the whole United States. And that helped build prosperity, which was certainly the goal of George Washington Littlefield, who paid for those statues and who had the idea of putting them there. Born in 1842 in Mississippi, a slaveholding family, came to Texas in 1850, fought in the Civil War for the Confederacy, rose to the rank of major, made a huge fortune in banking and in cattle. He had the bright idea to not only trail cattle, but to buy them cheap in Texas and sell them for more somewhere else. He was an entrepreneur. He was, in his own way, the Texas version of somebody like Andrew Carnegie, full of advice to his various relatives on how to live their lives, on how to be a better person, on how to make money. And he was also on the Regents here at UT in the teens. And he created the Littlefield Fund for Southern History to collect books and manuscripts about the Civil War. And as I said, he gave the money and had the idea, or with Coppini, had the idea for these statues. He approved the design, and the statues were supposed to go with the fountain. Three statues on each side. The design of the fountain, the design of the statues was to embody an American unity. Right? World War I sacrifice, great Americans, Civil War is something that all Americans, if you were white, could be proud of. I like to remember what Littlefield's bank was called. It wasn't called the Texas State Bank. It was called the American National Bank. It was an American bank. It was a national bank. And he was a national figure. And so one sort of way to sort of end my remarks is to think about this sort of mindset taken to its logical conclusion in the 1920s through the Ku Klux Klan. The Ku Klux Klan of the 1920s was also a national movement found in odd places like Indiana and Ohio and Oregon, as well as Texas. And what it tried to do is to find certain people as 100% American. If you were Protestant, if you were white, if you were English speaking, you could be 100% American. If you weren't, you were something else. And the statues are again part of this, defining a certain group as 100% American, including Confederate heroes, defining others as outside. So that's my remarks.
One, I'd like to open this up by saying, you know, thank you to the leadership of our chair, Professor Jones, who wrote an exquisite letter to the president before he took the statues down. And I think that it's important that we speak truth to power about about issues of racial justice, economic justice, gender justice, all these different things that are core values. And so I'd like to thank Jackie for her leadership. Very quickly, when we think about why is this a controversy, I'm going to come from a different perspective, a different take. Confederate memorials are un-American, and I'll say that again. And this is both a primer for people who are getting into arguments with their friends who think that the Confederacy is the greatest thing since sliced bread, and think that it's just about Southern heritage, and say, hey, I'm not racist, but I love the Confederate flag. Confederate symbols and Confederate memorials are un-American. They substitute a mythology of white supremacy for a hard-earned, hard-fought, multiracial, multicultural, multigendered, multisexual orientation democracy that we have today. So that's the first thing. Core American values of freedom, democracy, liberty, right? Not just individually, but collectively, have been built from the founding. Founding fathers and mothers had contradictions, but other people, including women, African Americans, Latinos, gay, LGBTQ, have utilized the core principles of the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution to reimagine and reconfigure American democracy. When Martin Luther King Jr. in 1963 writes from the letter from Birmingham jail, he talks about the young people who are being indicted and arrested by the hundreds in Birmingham are one day going to be lionized by this country, and he was right. What he says is that they'll be remembered for bringing us all back to those great wells of democracy that were dug deep by the founding fathers. King, the feminist movement, the women's rights movement, the farm workers movement reimagines American democracy. It makes it an inclusive, expansive experiment. So when we think about the Confederacy, there is no moral equivalency with those who died to sexually, financially, and physically exploit black people in perpetuity with those who fought on the side of freedom. The only reason we are having this conversation now, 150 years later, is because freedom's cause won the war, but lost the peace. So for the scholars in this room, the Dunning School of History, for those who are not scholars, the Klansmen by Thomas Dixon, Birth of a Nation by D.W. Griffith, Gone with the Wind, these are all dehumanizing popular and political cultural artifacts of not just white supremacy, but hatred for African Americans and black bodies. No empathy, no compassion, no citizenship. There was no second-class citizenship during the civil rights movement because democracies don't have classes of citizenship. So there was no citizenship for black people in the aftermath of the Civil War. There was no citizenship for the black sharecroppers who Fannie Lou Hamer and Stokely Carmichael and Ella Baker and Dr. King are trying to advocate on behalf of. The Confederacy is a living monument to the most reprehensible moral and political disasters and catastrophe that the world has ever seen in terms of racial slavery. So when your friends ask you, why should you not like the Confederacy, tell them because it's un-American and it contradicts our core values of freedom and democracy. Are you still with me? It's not about heritage. This is about citizenship. It's about humanity. We have a professor here, Dr. Rami Berry, who's got a brilliant book, The Price for Their Pound of Flesh, about the literal and figurative and spiritual value of black bodies during the antebellum period. We have all this new scholarship on slavery and racial capitalism. We have all this scholarship on mass incarceration. We have all this scholarship on the sexual exploitation of men, women, and children of color, but of every national background. What we're talking about is dehumanization, demonization, the disparagement of black bodies legally, legislatively, but culturally and politically that continues to persist even 50 years after the heroic period of the civil rights movement. So we've entered a point in our democracy where we can have these glaring juxtapositions of Confederate symbols and race rioting and tiki torches alongside of the first black president, alongside of black affluence and black excellence.
That's not progress. Those are contradictions. But those contradictions should not lead us astray from the notion that these symbols are un-American. They are un-American. There was a civil war that was supposed to litigate this, and 600,000 people perished in that civil war. For those people who want a book about that, This Republic of Suffering by Harvard's outgoing president, Drew Gilpin Faust, is the, one of the definitive books about death and the Civil War. It was litigated, but we lost the peace because Reconstruction turned into redemption, the Redeemer South, the South of not just white supremacy, but the South of Knight Riders, the South of the perpetual sexual rape of black women, of teens, of children, the South of the financial and political exploitation of black bodies. So on the one hand, there's the exploitation through the convict lease system, through sharecropping and peonage, and on the other hand, it's the perpetual marginalization of black bodies through Jim Crow that was supported by Texas politicians, that was supported by Northern politicians, that was supported by politicians in California. The American South is the United States of America. It's not South, West, North, and East. When Malcolm X says anything south of Canada is the South, he's exactly right. And that's what we're dealing with. And in closing, here's what I'll say. When we think about this notion of the Confederacy, this is about national identity and who we are as Americans. The reason I believe in American democracy is because of Fannie Lou Hamer. It's because of Harriet Tubman. It's because of Sojourner Truth. It's because of David Walker. It's because of Nat Turner. It's because of people who bled for democracy and for my right to exist. And so when we think about these symbols perpetuate a continual fraud and lie of normalizing white supremacy and normalizing domestic terrorism against not just black people, but their allies, white people and Latino people and people of color who were siding with humanity perished during these civil wars. And they perished during domestic terrorism and Mississippi's shotgun policy and the end of Reconstruction in Texas. They perished all over the world because they were fighting the good fight, freedom's cause, liberty, democracy, equality, and finally having citizenship. When Dr. King is saying his last speech, April 3rd, 1968, in Memphis, Tennessee, before he's assassinated the next day at the Lorraine Motel, what he says to the nation is, be true to what you said on paper. He talks about the Declaration of Independence. He talks about the Constitution. And he says that the greatness of America lies in the right to protest for right. That the yawning chasm between democratic ideals and democratic reality cannot be our identity. We are only liberty's surest guardian, both domestically and internationally, when we are true to our core values of freedom, democracy, equality, and justice for all. Thank you.
Well, that's hard to follow. I think Professor Buenger really talked about sort of what was going on at the time, what's the historical context of these monuments. And then Dr. Joseph, I think we got a sort of where we are now, and we saw both of those things in the discussion around the statues. You saw this, what did they mean at the time, what do they mean now, and that really comprise sort of the, you know, in a nutshell, the arguments of why the statues needed to be relocated. What I'm going to speak to you about is what happened next. President Gregory Fenves made his decision in August 2015 to remove the Jefferson Davis statue. And then in April 2017, the Briscoe Center, where I work, opened From Commemoration to Education, which is the statue exhibit. It's the Jefferson Davis statue relocated, but within this educational context. And that's about an 18-month process. So what I want to walk you through is a little bit about what happened in those 18 months. I'm not going to work through the history of the statues. I encourage you to come to the exhibit and look and sort of analyze that history itself. But what I want to point out is sort of what we did and how we went about it. Firstly, the Briscoe Center, which really has most of UT Austin's historical collections from the 1880s onwards, the majority of them at least, was really well placed to do this exhibit because we have the papers of George Washington Littlefield, the commissioned statues. We have papers of Pompeo Coppini, who sculpted the statues. And we have the university archives, which is where the statues ended up. So we had this amazing documentation, photographs, letters, contracts, receipts, that we were able to tell the story of the statue through. And I want to make a point about that. We chose deliberately to make the exhibit about the statue of Jefferson Davis. It's not an exhibit about Jefferson Davis, and it's not an exhibit about the links between commemoration and white supremacy. It's a historical treatment of the statue itself. We sought to ask, how did these statues end up at UT? What changed over the time? And now, why the statues at the Briscoe Center rather than on the Mall? And we actually, that has been, interestingly, a source of criticism from sort of both sides of the argument. We've had the Sons of the Confederate Veterans ask us why we haven't concentrated on these men of character and the great life of Jefferson Davis. And we've had people ask us why the statue isn't facing the wall like a naughty school child. And the answer in both occasions, or why the exhibit hasn't focused on the racism of Davis and the actions of Davis. And the reason is because the exhibit is about the statue, it's not about the man. And we very much sort of tried to leave those questions open to folks like yourselves who will come and to the exhibit to draw your own conclusions. What I thought would be a sort of alternative cliff notes to this would to point out some of the surprises that came up for me in the research phase of this. I curated the exhibit and I spent a good year going through these primary sources. So a few things have popped out. Just how contentious the monuments were in the 1920s. They were the source of vitriolic debate that was mostly kept out of the public eye, that was mostly encoded within correspondence at the time. But they were the source of contention and debate, especially around their financing and location before they were ever cast in bronze. We also noted just the politics of aesthetics. If you look at the statue, and we've got a picture of it here, this is the statue within the exhibit. These cases are full of primary source documentation from the archives I mentioned. This is not Jefferson Davis the traitor. This is not Jefferson Davis the U.S. Secretary of War. This is not Jefferson Davis the retired curmudgeon. This is Jefferson Davis the statesman. I'd actually argue Jefferson Davis the Christian statesman. This is Jefferson Davis the president. So there's a whole politics of the aesthetics of the statue itself, which is one of the reasons it's so important that these statues are preserved, whether it's in archival storage or in museum context, because they have within them historical evidence. They are rich in evidence. The evidence is encoded directly into the bronze work. And those are just some of the more general things we were able to look at just by looking at the aesthetics. Another thing about the aesthetics, the statue is 8.5 feet tall. And so for those of you who have come to see, it actually has, it seems relatively imposing off of its plinth. The idea of having it 8.5 feet is because it's on a plinth and therefore there's a perspective distortion. So 8.5 feet on a plinth is actually considered life size. But when you stand next to it, you know, you come up to about here if you mean, then it's it actually had quite an imposing presence even within a museum context. We also notice how mobile the statue is. You know, for 1,200 pounds of bronze, Briscoe Center is actually the fourth location in Austin that it's been publicly displayed. There's a myth of permanency and immovability that these statues have, but actually, as the documentation showed, it was sculpted in Chicago. It was cast in bronze in New York. It was then shipped, so it's cast in bronze by Yankees. It was then shipped to Galveston. It was then freighted to Austin. It was then displayed at Littlefield's Bank, on 6th and Congress. It was then displayed at the state capitol. It was then displayed on the South Mall, and it's now displayed at the Briscoe Center. So these statues, despite having this myth of permanency just in their very construction, they actually can get moved about quite easily, and history proves that. A couple of other things that stuck out for us. One was the role of social media. We had to discuss the recent history of the statutes, 2015 through to 2017. And that's a social media story for, in a large part. How do you curate tweets and posts? How do you preserve social media assets as primary source historical documents? That was a whole world of discovery for us as we curated the exhibit. And I think I want to touch on something I think both Walter and Peniel pointed to, which was just some of the insecurities that are encoded within the Littlefield Memorial. Is this a Southern memorial? Is this an American memorial? Is this a Texan memorial? Most of the people weren't actually born in Texas. I believe James Stephen Hoff was, which perhaps is an interesting take on his conclusion in this monument. He's very much the odd one out otherwise. But the context of World War I, when you've got students returning to campus talking about the Great War, not the Civil War, the Great War, what effect does this have on Confederate veterans who by this point are in their 70s and 80s and wondering about how the lost cause may be passed on to a new generation? I think I'll leave that there's a media relations story to this, but I think we're best sticking with history story today. Suffice to say that this is public history. This is, and there's a tension between sort of dumbing it down and giving a sort of ivory tower, academic language laden treatment of this. And so we had to try and bridge scholarship research and then having a public face so that this could be understood and then also act as a provocation for further debate and scholarship. I think what I'll leave this is with is that I think are two things. One is that there seems to be a sort of an emerging framework around Confederate statuary that we dealt with, and this framework has developed between Charleston and Charlottesville. And it's interesting how the mood has shifted dramatically between those two. You read the President's statements from 2015 regarding Confederate statues compared to recently, that shift is definitely in there. But what I leave it with is that there's this sort of emerging framework where there are these three vital questions, which is, what are the legacies of those being memorialized? What are their historic legacies? And then what were the motivations? I think Peniel spoke to that very eloquently. What are the motivations behind those who built these monuments? And I think, well, you spoke to that. And then finally, are these memorials present-day symbols of racism? Are they present-day rallying calls? Who are the most aggressive defenders of these monuments today? I think what that does, speaking on a personal note, is it probably puts the Confederate statues in a different place to, say, those of founding fathers. I think Peniel spoke very clearly about how, despite mixed legacies of those founding fathers, there are sort of transferable American ideals that can be reimagined in new communities today that can't be with Confederate symbols. In fact, the way those symbols are being reimagined today is in very negative, very ugly ways. Final thought, this problem was a problem that only the humanities could solve. We live on a modern academic campus where there's a lot of talk about STEM and deliverables and measurables and being prepared for the workplace, and sometimes the liberal arts and humanities can get relegated to a sort of personal discovery realm. But this was a problem that had everything to do with the humanities, had to do with history. And so for those of you studying here, I don't buy the argument that you're working on transferable skills. I think you're working on very concrete skills that will be used to solve future historical problems. Because here we have an example of how history doesn't just enrich or complicate the debates that Americans have about who they are. It's absolutely vital to the heart of politics, culture, and society, and it's vital to relations between Americans today. All right, thanks.
I was supposed to say at the beginning that this session is being recorded. I think I forgot that, so everybody... I did say, okay, good. Everybody has to be on the guest matters. So before we open this up to discussion, I just wanted to say a few words very quickly here and to acknowledge that there are arguments against taking these statues down. And they came from both the right and the left. From the right was the argument that somehow by taking the statues down, we were erasing history. Statues are not history. They do not affect history if they are here, if they are not here. These statues, as Walter pointed out, represented a certain memory, a certain perspective of history. We do not misuse or distort or ignore or erase history by taking these statues down. The argument that somehow these were statues representing Southern heritage. Well, certainly African Americans had nothing to do with the erection or placement of these statues. The idea that these statues represented the South in general, of course, is absolutely wrong. Heritage, what do we honor? What do we honor by erecting statues? Timothy McVeigh was very anti-government. He wanted to attack the government of the United States. He did so by bombing the federal building in Oklahoma City in April of 1995 and killing hundreds of people in the process. We would doubt that Timothy McVeigh should be honored with a statue. A plaque maybe somewhere, yes, in Oklahoma City where there are plaques, but whom do we honor by these memorials? What kind of heritage? I would argue that it is a heritage of hate, the Confederacy, that does not deserve to be memorialized in the form of these statues. Some argue, well, there's a slippery slope. You take down the statues of Jefferson Davis and Robert E. Lee tomorrow, today and tomorrow will be George Washington and Thomas Jefferson. I think we have to get back to the essential issues here, which are, why are these men being honored? George Washington and Thomas Jefferson are honored for their role in creating the United States of America. Yes, they were slaveholders, but they are not being honored in Washington and elsewhere for their role as slaveholders the way that Jefferson Davis and other leaders of the Confederacy are honored for trying to take down the United States government by force of arms. Okay, so from the left are some interesting points, I think. When I circulated the letter signed by 52 historians here at UT from five different departments, some people wrote back and said, look, what a waste, you know, we have bigger battles to fight than worrying about whether these statues stay on the UT campus or not. And to really, you know, make a big fuss about this would be to waste our political capital. Let's save our political capital and go after the big issues that affect the UT campus today. So that's one argument. The other was, look, by highlighting these statues and what they stand for, we play into the right, we play into this notion that we're only interested in identity politics. I would say these statues are, as Peniel said, they're an American issue. They're not an African American issue, not a Southern issue, they're an American issue. And the idea that somehow these statues represent the self-interest, taking them down represents the self-interest of a very small and identifiable group of people, I think it's wrong. And finally, some people say, well, we should have left these statues as reminders of this terrible era when they were constructed, Jim Crow, the violence and so forth, that it's important to contextualize them, put plaques there, educate people. That works only in certain instances. And it presupposes that people will stop, take time to read the plaques. A lot of these statues throughout the South are in the middle of busy traffic circles. It's impossible for people who will pass by to read anything that puts them into context. So anyway, I just wanted to acknowledge that although today we're talking about, you know, the effort to take these statues down here at UT, there have been arguments on both sides of the political spectrum about leaving them up.